usual one, Bob.
George, my wife, yeah, my wife also, who's there.
I'm a member of the pension fund, Chair.
Thank you. Okay. Right, thank you for those declarations. First, so minutes of our last meeting, agenda item 2. For those who've not had the opportunity to look at them in detail, if you want to scan your eyes over them, you'll have to be quick.
Focus around employer affordability and solvency of the fund.
data quality impact on employer pension contributions. We've sent a number of demands to employers requesting outstanding documentation. So we may process this data before submission of files to the actuary. Thank you, Chair. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Well, it's on the last point, really. On page 12 of the report, 2.17, and you just confirmed now you're on that, a number of requests have gone to employers seeking this documentation. Personally, I can't understand why it's not mandatory upon all employers to give us this information. Because what I'm concerned about is if some employers just choose not to respond, the facts and figures are all incorrect. Just there's no way we can actually say to these employers, you must give us the information and you must give us it by a certain date.
Unfortunately, there is a requirement in the LGBT regulations for employees to provide information within 3 months of the year end. But unfortunately, TPR have got no remit over employers. So we do, it's obviously in their best interest to provide the correct data to them because the liability calculations are based on data. And obviously, if the calculator, if they don't provide the data, calculations will be incorrect and employee contributions will be more because the actuary will take prudent assumptions. We have got within our pensions admin strategy remit to be able to pass on any censure costs that the fund may receive from TPR because of our data being poor, but other than that, we have not really got any strict regulations that we can set.
Okay, thanks, Jim.
Any other questions?
Just to ask about the planning which is referred to for the triennial review, 2.13. To ask about the planning for the triennial review which is referred to in 2.13. Where are we in that planning exercise and what do we anticipate?
We've had our initial discussions with the Chinese directors of the councils. We've discussed the level of prudence that we may be applying to the assumptions and maybe the merits of moving from a gilt plus model to a CPR plus model because that our liabilities are more closely correlated with CPR, so it makes sense for us to move towards that remit of calculating the liabilities. So we've had that initial discussions. We've requested financial planning from the local authorities for us to have a look at the strings against the employees so that we can work with the obviously taking account of solvency funds and national directives around level of prudence and functions and recovery periods, so the discussions around there.
Any other questions? We're happy to note the recommendations within the report. Okay, agenda item 4, which is investment criteria or cooling consultation, and then Peter is going to introduce that report to us.
Yes, thank you, Chair. We have spoken of cooling before, but the formal consultation came out at the end of November last year. Under section 2, I set out the background to cooling. The Chancellor referred to the proposal to create up to 6 British wealth funds with at least $25 billion of assets. Starting in section 2.3, I set out the 4 criteria that will be used to assess the proposals that are brought forward. Firstly, asset pools that achieve benefits of scale. In particular, looking at the bullet points, the size of the pools once fully operational, the type of pools they're participating in, including the legal structure, how the pools will operate, work to be carried out internally, and services to be provided from outside, and finally a timetable for establishing the pools, and again, authorities need to transparently report progress against that timetable. Under section 2.4, strong governance and decision making at the local level. Authorities need assurance that their investments are being managed appropriately in the pool, and also ensure that risk is adequately assessed and managed. Looking at the bullet points underneath, I just draw on three of those. Firstly, need to set out the governance structure for their pools, including the accountability between the pools and elected councillors, and how external scrutiny will be used, the shared objectives for the pools and any policies that are to be agreed between participants, and then further down how the authorities will act as responsible long-term investors through the pools, including how the pools will determine and enact stewardship responsibilities. The third criteria under 2.5 is reduced costs and excellent value for money. Authorities are expected to take a lead in this area and report the costs they incur more transparently. Moving to the top of page 19, the particular points to be answered is a fully transparent assessment of investment costs as at March 2013, and on a similar basis, costs at March 2015. Apologies for that mistake. A detailed estimate of savings over the next 15 years, and then a detailed estimate of implementation costs, and also transition costs, and an explanation of how these costs will be met. And then finally, under section 2.16, an improved capacity to invest in infrastructure. Overall, only a small proportion of local government scheme assets are invested in infrastructure. Authorities should explain the proportion of their funds currently allocated to infrastructure, both directly and through funds, how they might develop or acquire the capacity and capability to assess infrastructure projects, and finally, the proportion of their fund they intend to invest in infrastructure in this area going forward. Under section 2.7, initial proposals need to be submitted by the 19th of February, and those submissions should include a commitment to pooling, a description of progress towards formalising arrangements. Under 2.8, a refined and completed submission is required by the 15th of July, which fully addressed the criteria set out in the previous sections of this document. As we say, under section 2.8, once submitted, the government will assess the final proposals against the criteria. A brief report will be provided in response, and any areas where the government believes they have not been adequately addressed. And section 2.9 refer to a report called Project Pool, which Merseyside Pension Fund has worked with a number of other local authority funds in producing. That report was actually formally released today, and I'm proposing to make a presentation on the report at the Governors and Risk Working Party on Thursday this week. But the report has three main goals. One, to produce an evidence-based and objective analysis of pooling options. Secondly, to narrow those options down. And finally, to form a basis of discussion between the LGPS and the government. Below that, which should be section 2.10, which is number 3, the fund has had a number of meetings with Northern funds to discuss options for pooling. At the time of this report being written, we've agreed in principle to work with two other funds, and we're hoping that one or two other funds may also join the pool by the time we get to the 19th of February. Number of risks set out in section 3. Important that appropriate governance arrangements are put in place to ensure that pooling arrangements work well now, but also in the future. As set out in the Project Pool report, the cost and resource required to deliver this change shouldn't be underestimated. The transition of assets has never been undertaken on this sort of scale. The largest big transition was the transition of the Royal Mail Pension Fund to the government. And that's about 20 billion of assets. Clearly, we're talking about to 150 million of assets, so it's a much more substantial transition as and when that happens. So it's very important that strong project management and the use of skilled and experienced transition managers July aren't very far away, and there's a great deal of work to be done between now and then. In terms of consultation, the chair of this committee has been consulted and involved in a number of meetings. We've obviously spoken to other LGPS funds. We have sought to consult with the other significant stakeholders in the fund, principally the other district Merseyside authorities. Resource implications are set out under Section 8. Government is looking to deliver substantial savings, and the expectation is that there will be substantial savings over time, but in the short term there will be costs incurred, and the benefits will be more realised by smaller funds than by larger funds as ourselves. There was a contribution of £10,000 that we made towards the cost of being involved in the project report. Under recommendations, one recommendation 30.1 is that members note the report and authorise office to continue developing pooling options. Proposal for a second recommendation, which really ties in with the executive summary at the beginning of this report, is that members agree that officers prepare a response to the consultation in conjunction with the chair of committee. Thank you, Chair.
I'm sure you may have some questions. So we do have two recommendations, and if we just remember that we are working towards the deadline of the 19th of February, and so let's ask away.
Under three, we said we were working on two other funds. Can I just ask, at this moment, 19, you know, it's just less than 3 weeks away, or just over 3 weeks away, are there any other expressions of interest in coming into that pool?
Yes, we publicly announced that we're working very closely, and have been for a while, with the Greater Manchester Pension Fund and West Midlands Pension Fund. West Yorkshire. We've also, it started, I guess you would call it a beauty parade, really, where a number of people have come along and liked the look of Merseyside Pension Fund and wondered if we could do business. And over a period of time, some of those other pension funds have perhaps fallen away, seen somebody else they might like to work with. And but I'll say publicly that I've been pushing all along for a northern pension fund. Some of the southern funds have not made my comments, and so we are left pretty much with a northern pension fund. Some of the northeast authorities, certainly Northumberland, Tyne and Wear, and Durham, are certainly talking with us and expressing interest. But specifically, it's Greater Manchester, West Yorkshire, and Merseyside who have taken the lead and have been pushing.
Quick one, Paul, if you don't mind. In terms of the infrastructure fund, how much will that benefit to the Merseyside authorities?
Well, if we looked at the pension funds that are talking and potentially, correct me if I'm wrong, Peter, I'm sure you might, potentially we're looking at about $56 billion in the assets. So then it depends what percentage of that would be available for infrastructure investment and where that infrastructure investment might be made. Again, I've always been pushing to make sure that any of those funds that are available that are kept or invested on Merseyside. Peter, would you like to comment on the potential percentage that might be available?
Numbers seem to vary between 5 and 10% could be allocated to infrastructure. In terms of infrastructure, the proposal is most likely that there's some sort of national platform for infrastructure investments across the UK. There's also been allied with that a so-called clearinghouse where potential infrastructure projects will be presented to this platform to see whether they're investable or not. But as the chair says, we think there's also the opportunity for investments to be made in the region as well.
Thank you.
Obviously, a sense of a spread, a kind of upper and lower level, in terms of what those cost savings might be for the fund?
Thanks, Chair. I very much welcome the availability of schemes, if there are any, for infrastructure investments in the pension funds and the pension sector to invest in infrastructure. Most infrastructure in the UK is free to use at the moment anyway, so the rate of return is very low. I just wonder what kind of assurances they've had, the pension funds and LGPS have had from Treasury and other interested parties to suggest that rate of return is sufficient to warrant the pension fund's interest? And secondly, what kind of flexibility is there to change the name from British Wealth Funds? They are members' funds, and it's important that the name reflects the fact that they belong to members and not to Treasury.
I think that's a very good point, John. Peter, you may wish to comment, and I might have some comments, but I think that's a point well made. The funds are our pensioners.
Yes, technically, and I'm careful about this, technically they should not be described as wealth funds because wealth funds don't have liabilities in the technical use of the term. So they shouldn't be described in that way because as a pension fund we have liabilities. But in terms of the principle of pooling, yes, I'm sure there's a better name for the collaboration of local authority funds.
And I think we all recognise the fact that our first responsibility is to those pensioners that we sit here for tonight is to make sure that the pensions are paid on time and in full, and I think that the comments are quite correct. But if, you know, if there is an opportunity to invest in Merseyside, then I can promise you we'll be fighting in that corner, John.
And the first question about any assurances? Yes.
Yeah, I think that comment is well made, and when I've been in discussion with the heads of West Yorkshire and to Manchester, but we've spoken about that point time and time again. What we don't want to see is that our funds are taken off to invest in some, you know, motorway project what we want to see, obviously, is projects that will benefit our local economy on Merseyside, and already, you know, the chairs of West Yorkshire and Manchester have expressed a willingness to look at projects that might come forward in Merseyside. So I think it's very positive, but our first responsibility, of course, is that any schemes that are considered would bring stable and good returns for the pensioners. That's the question.
Chair, one final question, please. I'm concerned, you know, from a pensioner's point of view, I wouldn't like to see the use of government directives to direct the fund, you know, the new pool fund, into a low rate of return that it could expect elsewhere.
Yeah, Peter, you've got your answer to comment on that.
I think the way the consultation is written, the Secretary of State recognises that if he was to direct investment, then effectively our liabilities could be put onto the public balance sheet. So I think he'll be careful not to do that. It's an important principle that asset allocation decisions remain with the local pensions committee, and any decisions to allocate to infrastructure will come to this committee.
one to this report contained within the supplementary agenda. 1.2 refers to the key financial management headlines for the fund, including the value of the fund as at the 30th of September 2015 being 6.5 billion. It is estimated that 272 million paid to pensions will be made during the year and the fund will receive 196 million in contributions. 1.3 provides an explanation to the lower estimated contributions for 2016-17 compared with previous years, the reason being the option taken by a number of employers to pay their three-year deficit payments upfront as a one-off payment during 2014-15. The proposed total budget for the fund is 19.1 million, which includes 12.6 million of investment management fees to external managers. The proposed budget is 0.29% of assets under management. Section 2 outlines the methodology used to compile the 2016-17 budget. Appendix 1 also details the budget approved by this committee for 2015-16 and the predicted outturn for 2015-16, although 2.2 of the report highlights that the outturn cannot be predicted with complete accuracy due to the volatility in financial markets and delays with billing and suppliers. The actual outturn will be reported to this committee in June. 2.3 refers to the fund's major expenditure and investment management fees. The outturn for 2015-16 and the budget for 2016-17 are lower due to market volatility and efficiencies gained through renegotiated fees. 2.4 refers to the second highest expenditure, staffing, and informs members that the budget for 2016-17 reflects increased national insurance contributions, the carried forward growth in administration, and the additional 100,000 of growth in the investments team. 2.5 highlights the reasons for the predicted underspend for supplies, largely due to delays in planned IT projects, which have been carried forward to 2016-17. 2.6 highlights that additional costs associated with the triennial actuarial evaluation have been built into this budget. The departmental and central support charges for 2016-17 are the same as the previous year, $5,600. Section 3 of this report informs members that the fund has recently reviewed its risk register, identifying key risks and mitigating controls. A key feature of the controls is having appropriate resources available to administer the fund adequately and to manage investments. This budget provides adequate resources for those two core functions. Section 4, other options considered, reminds members that the largest area of expenditure is investment management costs, which are subject to regular review. Although there has been a careful review process of all expenditure and with the head of the pension fund approving discretionary expenditure within the budget. 8.1 of this report informs members that the costs of the pension fund are charged directly to the pension fund and are then ultimately recovered by investment income and employee and employer contributions. The full costs are estimated to be £148.59 per member or 0.29% of assets under management. Section 13 of this report are the recommendations. 13.1 asks members to approve the budget for 16-17. 13.2 recommends that a further report is brought to the committee in June with the actual outturn for 15-16, along with finalised estimates for salary recharges, support charges and any further identified expenditure for 2016-17. The approval of this budget for MPF by this committee forms part of the governance arrangements for the Merseyside Pension Fund. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you, Dawn. Have you any questions? If not, then do you have recommendations on items 13, 1 and 2? John?
Do I recall 0.3% being the appropriate figure for last year's operating costs relative to the pensions fund? So it just shows the scale of advancements in the last 12 months that although costs have risen marginally, unfortunately they've decreased by 50% because the fund has grown so significantly.
It's a point there, thank you, John. We always expect that sort of comment from you, thank you. Thank you very much. Donna, sir, congratulations. Thank you. Are we happy to know the recommendations?
Thank you.
Agenda item 6, which Peter will present on training opportunities. Can I just comment on this? One thing that's evident to me when I'm sitting in committee
senior members of the committee that we do bring on an event-by-event basis papers to this committee seeking approval for members to attend.
Thank you, Peter. In Appendix 1, there's a list of training opportunities for the forthcoming year, if members of the committee can avail themselves of that knowledge, and should they wish to attend, they can do so. Any questions? We're happy with that. Thank you. Our next agenda, item 7, is to do with local government pension scheme investment regulations.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This paper provides details of the consultation on proposals to revoke and replace the existing local government investment regulations and seeks approval. It says it seeks approval for the response attached. There isn't a response attached, I'm afraid. We're still working on a response. This consultation is in parallel with the pooling consultation. The government recognises that the investment regulations do inhibit potential for collaboration and working together, and so these two consultations are running in parallel. So with permission of this committee, I will prepare a response and submit it once the Chair has approved it. Under Section 2, set out some background. As we say, the consultation is being undertaken in parallel with the consultation on the pooling of LGPS assets. Under Section 2.3, provides some background to the review of fiduciary duty. That was first addressed by the K Review, which published a report in July 2012, and that was followed up by the Law Commission, also reviewing fiduciary duties of investment intermediaries. And again, they published their report in July 2014 and asked the department to clarify two particular regulations, which are set out under section 2.14. Under section 2.7, just a reminder really that assets that are being invested in the best interests of members and beneficiaries, and in the case of a potential conflict of interest, in the sole interest of members and beneficiaries. Under section 2.18, the LGPS is a statutory scheme and therefore it's not subject to trust law, and those responsible for making investment decisions are not therefore required to comply with Regulation 4 of the 2005 regulations. However, as 2.9 explains, nonetheless, the body stands somewhat in the position of trustees or managers of the property of others. So those in local government responsible for making investment decisions must act in accordance with ordinary public law principles, in particular the ordinary public law principles of reasonableness. Under 2.11, having fully considered the recommendation by the K Review and supported by the Law Commission and the government, ministers are satisfied that the scheme is consistent with the national legislative framework governing the duties placed on those responsible for making investment decisions. The next sentence should read, the position of common law is also indistinguishable from that produced by the 2005 regulations applicable in respect to trust-based schemes. Ministers do, however, propose to remove the requirement for the performance of investment managers to be reviewed once every 3 months from the regulations. So in developing the draft regulations, the government has sought to deregulate and simplify the regulations. Those provisions that are covered by general law haven't been carried forward. So the requirement to act prudently and the requirement to act and take an act on proper advice are still covered. But they're removing the schedule on limitations on investments and instead introducing a prudential approach. So keys to this is set out under section 2.15. Instead of a statement of investment principles, there will now be an investment strategy statement produced which covers requirements for recognition of risk and diversification. There's a need for transitional arrangements and there's a proposal for to maintain the state investment principles. Non-financial factors, there's been some clarification set out under section 2.18. The Secretary of State has made clear that using pensions and procurement policies to pursue boycotts, divestments and sanctions against foreign nations and the UK defence industry are inappropriate, other than where formal legal sanctions, embargoes and restrictions have been put in place by government. So that the draft replacement regulations include provisions for ministry authorities to publish their policies on the extent to which environmental, social and corporate governance matters are taken into account in the selection, retention and realisation of investments. But guidance on how these policies should reflect foreign policy and related issues will be published ahead of the new regulations coming into force. So under 2.19, there are four questions that the Department for Communities and Local Government are asking. In relation to the first question, our thinking at the moment is that clearly there is less detail in the draft regulations that have been produced, and also there's uncertainty about the nature of the guidance that will be produced. But we do believe that the government's desire to simplify and deregulate the regulations is very positive, and for that reason, we believe it's right that there is less detail in the regulations, because then there's less for lawyers to pick over and challenge. But nonetheless, we do think in producing the guidance, there should be perhaps a strengthening of what's suggested at the moment as a reference to the Secretary of State taking advice to consult such persons, and we feel it's perhaps appropriate for that advice to be received from a working group of practitioners and investment experts. The second question, are there any specific issues that should be reinstated? We think the answer is no. Is 6 months the appropriate period? Yes, we think 6 months is quite long enough for us to produce a statement of the new investment strategy statement. And then finally, there's a question about derivatives. And again, we think that's slightly restricting for derivatives only to be used for risk mitigation. We believe that what is allowed in the private sector should be mirrored in the public sector, which is around